last week we did an episode called Anne Hathaway, and in
Anne Hathaway.
Sorry. I'm so sorry. We did an episode called Anne Hathaway. And in one of my rants, I went off on, I'm obsessed with film festivals. We talk about it all the time. We try to go to them. And I've been obsessively following the Cannes Film Festival. And then very quickly, I realized, oh, Anne's there. Let's get Anne on the podcast. And then we made magic happen. And now we have Anne on the podcast. Hello, Anne.
Hello. It's great to be here. Thank you for the invite.
From Variety? Is that
yes.
How I should? Okay. Well, yeah, I mean, if you look at Anne's resume, it's literally, if there is any sort of online or print journalism Anne has written for them, it's kind of fascinating.
Yes, thank you. I've written for a ton of places. I do reporting for Variety. For Cannes, I was there in the capacity with France Media Group, so that's who sends me there. But I, at the same time, I was doing reporting for Variety on Saturday Night Live, so like waking up at 5 a.m. to watch the SNL finale France, which was a lot. So TV and film, but yes, Cannes for France Media Group, and it was amazing. It was my sixth year there, and it's just like a super glamorous summer camp. Kind of, because it's the same faces and new faces and parties and like long hot days, and it's just super exciting.
Do you feel like SNL is funnier when watching it in France, or does it just feel a bit more pedestrian?
What a unique question.
Yeah. Like,
that's Ethan's thing. He's the unique question guy.
I would say it felt less funny watching it from France.
Mm.
But also the finale, I don't know if any of you guys watched it, but it didn't feel really finale worthy, sort of, in my opinion. But it was fine. Jake Gyllenhaal did a decent job.
We all remember Anne's very famous articles that she puts out weekly that just says Saturday Night Dead. That's Anne's famous every week. That's her.
Yep. That's all I need to write.
Every week.
I love that.
This, of course, is I Need to See That, a podcast about the Cannes Film Festival and Furiosa. I'm Scrotus.
I'm Caroline.
And I'm Rectus.
Yay! I was hoping you'd say that.
Oh, boy.
And this is Variety's Anne McCarthy. And I've so many questions about the Cannes Film Festival. I want to get into it. I want to get into the movies. I want a straight up 20-minute conversation about standing ovations.
Oh,
because
yeah.
This is a perspective I need to hear. But do you all want to talk about Furiosa first? And did you see Furiosa at Cannes?
I did. It was the first thing I saw, and I saw it at 8:30 a.m. So it was like a really
what a way to wake
no
up
need to have
start
coffee
into
that
the day.
Day.
Yeah. Wait. Exactly.
And how many movies did you see total this con?
I averaged like two a day, I think.
Okay.
The festival's 12 days long, so I was there only for 11 days. I didn't stay the entire time. So yeah, 20 films around there, I would say.
Wow.
Some people see 3 to 4 per day, which you can easily do because they run screenings just around the clock. But yeah, probably saw about 20 movies. And by the end of it, you're kind of like, okay, keep my eyes open. And the chairs, the seating is like very comfortable in all the theaters. Like it's these really plush red velvet kind of seats that are high back, so it's very easy to fall asleep for the boring films.
Sure.
But I tried to go like, yeah.
Wait,
what's
they
the
allow
snack
snacks?
Situation?
Yeah.
That's oh my god, that was gonna be my question too. You guys, we did it.
Oh my god.
Yeah, what's the snack sitch?
Yeah.
I'm gonna break your American hearts. There are no snacks. Say
okay.
Until D. It's prohibited.
Wow.
No drinks, no snacks. Yeah. So sometimes people do like sneak things in.
Sure.
Sometimes I'll bring a Coke Zero in the theater with me or something. But yeah, no snacks.
Wow.
Yeah.
I don't know what I would do. Furiosa is a snack movie. Like, I get it if you're seeing like Anora and you're just like, yeah, fine, I'm into this. But like, Furiosa is a popcorn movie.
Totally. Yeah, I agree. Yeah, I really enjoyed Furiosa more than I thought I would.
Yeah, it's interesting. And of course, we could get into the conversation about it fucking bombed at the box office. Like, there's no way around it.
Wow.
And like, we'll talk about Furiosa. I think we've all seen it now, right? Mm-hmm. Caroline and Ethan, you Rectus and Scrotus. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But you saw it at 8 a.m. It was that the first screening? Were the celebrities there at 8 a.m.?
No, I think it was the night prior that was the premiere. So I saw it for like a press screening very early in the morning. But in general, I feel like it kind of buzz was good about it. Like people were excited about it.
Yeah, I think this is one of the unique situations where critical reviews, I don't, Rotten Tomatoes is not gospel. I am not condoning Rotten Tomatoes, but it's at like 90% on there. And yet, talking to people, it's either I haven't seen it or it was okay. I had a great time watching Furiosa. I think the worst part about Furiosa is that it's not Fury Road, and I can't judge a movie on something it is not. Having said that, the end credits, spoiler alert, are clips from Fury Road. And that absolutely hurt my viewing of it because I watched it and I was having fun. I was dancing. Important note, I was literally the only person in my theater, so much so that it didn't start. It was supposed to start at 9:30, and at 9:40, I went out and had to tell somebody that my movie never started.
Oh, my God.
And then
God.
They started it without trailers or anything. It just started. I was literally the only one, which I think I texted Ethan and Caroline at the end because I was like, it's kind of a unique experience to see a big movie on its opening weekend. It was a Friday night. I was the only one in the theater. And out loud, I screamed, "What's that guy from? Oh, yeah. It's the guy from Mank." That's out loud. That was me screaming at the theater.
This is your dream movie situation.
Honestly, I had a good time. Yeah. I was laughing.
Did you say you were dancing?
Yeah, I was dancing. I literally stood up and danced.
The scene when Hemsworth's nipples got ripped off? Like, what scene were you dancing in?
Can we talk? So his nipples get ripped off. Was that always his plan?
Yeah, I think he wanted to.
He made the choice to connect his nipples to the weird, hard to hold arrow thing.
Yeah.
And immediately his nipples get ripped off. Is that his choice?
I mean, I guess it was the best option.
Anyway, what did you all feel about Furiosa?
Well, I saw it on Saturday night, and I saw it with a friend who's my age, and we both. The theater was 45% full, and we were both talking about how in high school this is what you did. We were like, where are the 16-year-old boys?
Where are the young people? Yeah.
Like, I saw Casino Royale Friday night. It opened and it was so good. I went back Saturday night. Like, this is what we did.
The Woody
in high
Allen
school.
Movie?
Yeah,
the Woody Allen version. Yeah. They were showing it in the local theater, and I'm like, give me more of that Woody Allen spoofing. Yeah, it's like, where were the 16-year-old boys? It made no sense to me that it was a bunch of people my age and older and no young people at all.
Yeah, were you all midnight movie people in high school, college?
Yeah,
100%. I was midnight dressing up. We dressed up like all of the X-Men for X-Men 3. I was Juggernaut. I had a bucket on my head. We dressed up like Elf for Elf. Oh. We dressed up like a sailboat for Master and Commander. We dressed up like wine bottles for Sideways. We dressed up like spiders for Eight-Legged Freaks. This is absolutely
would not have been
my
friends.
Thing.
This was too much.
We wouldn't have been friends? Are you kidding?
Dressed up like wine bottles for Sideways. That's the
Let us know in the comments if you would have been friends with Eli in high school.
Please don't leave that comment.
I love it. Yeah.
So you had a packed screening, Anne, with friends.
Yes, totally packed. Every screening I was in was packed, which is like, it's such a fun environment because everyone there is obsessed with movies. And, you know, they have like a last minute queue that's also often packed if someone doesn't show up. So it's just like people super eager to get into every single screening. And but yeah, it was a packed Furiosa. I feel like the audience there loved it and was really into it. Overall, it got pretty positive reviews, I remember reading, but you know, reviews don't translate to box office numbers, so it's like
it's wild.
It's hard. Yeah.
Did you like the movie?
I did. I liked it. And I must say, I have not actually seen Fury Road, or this was my first Mad Max movie I ever saw.
I just saw Fury Road a week ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
How'd you liked it?
Okay. So I liked Fury Road a lot. And then seeing Furiosa like 4 days later, I was like, eh. I think like, because I loved the pacing of Fury Road. I feel like it's hard for me to talk about Furiosa without talking about the ending, because that, I think, knocked it down a star and a half for me.
Yeah.
I think that felt like, okay, sure. I just felt like I was like talking about it with a few of my other friends, and I just felt like Furiosa would do something more intense to him, and it just sort of kind of felt like a throwaway having that be the ending with what happens to Chris Hemsworth.
Yeah, I thought it was, I feel similarly. I wanted something kind of like bigger, sort of.
Yeah. So it just kind of felt like a ho-hum sort of ending to the movie.
Yeah. I thought like visually it was incredible. Like the production value was amazing. And I love that part of it. Like, it's such a feast for the eyes, the whole movie. Mm-hmm. And yeah.
I liked Furiosa. I've seen all of the Mad Max movies. Ethan, I'm guessing you did too, right?
Yeah.
Have you seen all the Mad Max? Do you have a ranking?
Yeah. Fury Road first, Warrior.
Yes.
Probably Furiosa.
Yes.
Original Mad Max, Beyond Thunderdome.
100%. That's absolutely the correct answer.
Can I ask about the ending? Because I agree, it didn't feel as to answer Chris Hemsworth's question, like she didn't make it epic enough. Do you think that if this movie had come out 9 months after Fury Road with Charlize Theron back in 2015, as he had intended it to be, that the punch would have been harder? And the fact that, I know, Anne, you haven't seen Fury Road, Caroline, you just saw it a week ago, but if this was a true reaction to what we had just all seen 9 months ago, that ending would have been more meaningful than we had to wait 9 years to just sort of see this?
Yeah. I think that's the problem with prequels in general. We knew how it was going to end. You didn't know like how she was going to treat Chris Hemsworth's character, but you knew she was going to survive. You knew she was going to move on to Fury Road. I don't know. I don't know if it would be better or worse. I mean, we could make this a conversation about would this be better or worse with Charlize Theron instead of Anya Taylor-Joy, and transfer this conversation to the performances. Okay. Because I was surprised at how little Anya Taylor-Joy was in this movie after seeing it publicized as an Anya Taylor-Joy movie.
Yeah.
I liked her. I like her in everything. She just looks so specific in a way, you know. She just has such a look to it. I was good with all the performances. I liked Hemsworth in it. I know people are a little divisive on him. I thought that the two scenes that were why we saw the movie were amazing. And I agree. Overall, Eli, I agree. The worst part about this movie is it wasn't Fury Road. And I just didn't get that like tingle that you get at the end of the movie or even halfway through and you just go, I'm watching something special. And that's 100% what I got watching Fury Road. Halfway through Parasite, you're like, am I watching the greatest movie of all time? And never once in this movie was I like, I'm seeing something special. It was, I'm seeing something fun, I'm seeing something awesome, but it's not hitting that next tier for me.
I think also having seen Fury Road just a week ago, I was confused half the movie thinking that Chris Hemsworth was going to be Immortan Joe. And then when Immortan Joe showed up, I was like, oh, why do I care about this other guy? Like, why am I, I'm like more intrigued because I was like, I want to know about, you know, reverse inside out King Triton over here. And like what happens with like the two of, I want to know, I think I was more interested in knowing about what happened, I guess, like for more of like Furiosa and Immortan Joe, because I think that's more interesting to me than I think the story we were told in Furiosa.
Sure.
Because I think because then it has more investment in because of Fury Road. What else?
I have three thoughts. One, I'm obsessed with the idea, and that you saw this without seeing Fury Road, because I think the best parts of this movie were kind of like Fury Road. And that's what I liked about the movie. I also am okay with movies not being the best movie I've ever seen. In fact, I kind of like that more. I'm sick of movies being the best movie I've ever seen. I've seen so many movies this year where I'm like, I love this movie. And then, like, thinking back, I'm like, it's not as good as last year. I thought Anya Taylor-Joy was great because of the special effect that is her face. She's like, her eyes communicate so much. I think Chris Hemsworth is hilarious. I like the fake nose. You know how I feel about fake noses, but I kind of like the way they played. I think Tom Burke steals this movie. I want more Tom Burke in my life.
Was he the guy with the painted forehead?
Is he?
Yeah.
Praetorian Jack.
Yes.
Praetorian Jack.
I liked him. He was good.
Yeah, he was great.
I want 20 more movies starring Scrotus. Maybe like a couple starring Rictus. I liked young Furiosa. I thought she was cool.
She was lovely.
I want to see... I liked her mom a lot. I thought that was a cool character. I want to see an entire, like... I don't know. Try to think who would be a good director for this. I want to see a Wes Anderson-directed movie about the History Man that just follows the adventures of that tattooed guy, the History Man. I thought it was a good movie. I thought it was fine. It's not going to be on my top 10. It's not the best movie I've ever seen. Mm-hmm. It is not Fury Road, which I truly feel like is one of the best movies ever made. Mm-hmm. I think Fury Road is one of the movies that changed how we watch movies. And Furiosa is just a fine movie. I don't know. I'm sick of prequels.
What made Fury Road so special in your eyes?
The special effects, how it is filmed. It's you know the best part of Fury Road is that, like, the chase scene in the giant tanker, right? Mm-hmm. Would you say that's probably one of the best scenes? That is the whole movie. That's Fury Road. It's that for for 90 minutes or whatever.
Okay.
There's no story, there's no real dialogue. It's just that. And the effects are cool. It's unlike anything you've ever seen. It's, I don't know. I think it's a stunning movie.
Yeah. I think that the pure, like, creative expression that George Miller found, like, he really sort of, in Fury Road, he took the, what did Denis Villeneuve say? Like, movies shouldn't have dialogue. Like, movies are about sounds and images. Like, that's what Fury Road is. It is all image. It's all sound. It's pure creativity. He doesn't give a shit that it doesn't connect to previous versions. He doesn't give a shit about the logic of how the world has burned. He's just saying, this is my big creative swing, and it works. I think that the big part of it is, like, it just works. Whatever, like, qualifier you need to put on that, or, like, mathematical equation, I don't know, but that movie works. I would love to hear what you think about it, having seen Furiosa first.
Yeah, Anne, please come back after you see Fury Road and tell us everything. Yeah.
One thing that I did find hard to believe in Fury Road was Riley Keough's hair color. Knowing that there's no water, there's no hair dye, that is not a natural shade of red. And as someone who has had 15 different shades of red, there is no way she could have had that in Gastown or Creighton, whatever. Like, so that was the hardest thing for me to
process. We're coming for you, Riley Keough. You need to sell Graceland so we can come at you. You can pay for your lawyers.
This is why Ethan is trying to scam you out of Graceland. This is why it's Ethan's company doing this to you. Hey, Anne, when you watch Mad Max Fury Road, please look for the character of Slit, because it is played by an actor named Josh Hellman, who plays Scrotus in this movie. I just learned that.
Okay, good to know. I will.
He also played Will Stryker in the X-Men Days of Future Past and Apocalypse movies.
Okay.
Anyway, thank you, IMDb. That is our thoughts on Furiosa. Here's what I'm going to say. If you're listening to this podcast and you're like, should I see this movie? The answer is yes, and in a theater, and oh my God, go see movies in theaters. I can't live without movies in theaters. Do this for me. Go see the movie. Just go see it. Just for me, go see it. And guess what? This isn't con rules. You can bring snacks.
Exactly.
You can buy a package of sour Skittles and very loudly eat them until your tongue kind of burns because they're too sour. All right, let's talk con. Anne, I have so many questions for you. And here's the most important question I could ever ask you.
I'm ready.
Did you see Megalopolis?
I did see Megalopolis.
Ethan just walked away.
Ethan just left
Ethan
the
just
podcast.
Got up and walked away. He doesn't want to hear anything.
Is it out yet? When's
I don't know what you're
date?
Allowed to tell us. I don't know what you're allowed to tell us. What did you say?
I said, is it out? When's the is it out yet? When's the release date?
I think there's no release
date. I don't
date.
Think it got purchased by anybody. I don't think any
you're right.
company
it
is
doesn't have
willing...
distribution. Yeah, that's
yeah.
right. That's
yes.
right.
I think, because remember they did a screening a long time ago before Con, where they showed clips where they're like, please buy this movie. And everyone's like, no,
yes.
I'm not going to buy this movie. And then Ethan was trying to use his pajama boy money. Ethan famously was in a campaign for Obama as pajama boy. That the hardline Republicans make fun of him for. This is a fact. Google pajama boy. That's Ethan.
But apparently it got me a lot of money.
Yeah, it got him a lot of money. He monetized pajama boy.
He did Graceland.
And now he's trying to buy a movie starring Shia LaBeouf. I don't know what you're allowed to tell us about Megalopolis. We do not want any spoilers. We are obsessed with this movie. Can I just ask one quick question?
Yes.
Yes or no? That's the question. Yes or no?
Oh, yes.
But there was a shrug. There was a shrug with the
yeah,
yes.
Yeah. Because in my opinion, there are two types of critics out there. There are people who say, this is the best movie ever made. He did it again. And those who say, what the fuck is this movie? This is the most batshit swing I've ever seen in my life.
I lean more towards the latter, that it's like very out there, very batshit. But it's also compelling, and it's like really visually quite interesting. The acting's pretty good. Like, it's just sort of, there's no movie I can think of that's like it, kind of. And it's fun to see movies like that, even when they're a little bit off the rails and crazy. And there was also, I won't spoil it because I don't know how it will be in theaters or on streamers, like what the experience will be like. But there's a moment in the film where something happens that I've never experienced before when I, like, you know, I've seen hundreds of movies, and I can't say more without giving it away, but there's like something very special and cool that they do.
So I know that Coppola said that he wanted this to be a movie that people gather every year and watch it to discuss society like we do It's a Wonderful Life. So are you every holiday season going to get with your full family and just go, we want to watch Megalopolis to discuss the rise and fall of society? Did that movie inspire you to maybe do that?
Definitely not. It's, cool. It's a hard pass on okay. that. It's an annual family activity. But yeah, I think Adam Driver's great. He was great in it. It was a little bit.
Does the haircut play?
Does the haircut?
Because I'm obsessed with the haircut they gave him.
Oh yeah, I'm trying to remember what his hair even looked like. Yeah, it is a little bit.
I think grown out gladiator cut that Clooney had in the 90s.
Yeah. Yes, that's right. Yeah, yeah. And his haircut kind of fit with the whole film had like a very Shakespearean tone to it, kind of, and it like very. To the point of being cartoonish, like a Shakespeare cartoon sometimes. So like the haircut fit in with that. But there was also a lot of reports that came out. You guys may have seen some of them, that like negative press apart from even the film itself, but the filming of it, and like that nobody really wants to touch it, and will it ever get picked up and all this stuff, and how Francis Ford Coppola is like handsy with some of the extras, the female extras on set.
Yeah.
And there was some article I read that described those incidences and said, he was acting in a really old school way on the set instead of just like actually saying what it was.
Yikes.
Yeah. But no, I thought it was interesting. Interesting movie.
Do you see it? Because we don't know if it's ever going to be released. We don't. I mean, in my opinion, it should just be, I'm going to say another problematic figure. It should be a Louis C.K. situation where he just releases it on his website and then everyone buys it for $2.
Yeah.
Do you think it would play better in theaters, or do you see this being a streaming movie?
It's totally a movie you see in theaters. Yeah. I think it's like meant for a movie theater. So I really hope it does get distribution just for the sake of people that want to see it. Yeah.
I'm oddly, like, I'm more excited about it now. Like, good. I don't know why. Like, the mystery and the intrigue of everyone who you hear talk about it goes, yeah, that movie. And that makes me want to see it so badly.
And who is most surprising performance-wise for you in the movie?
Oh, good question. I really liked the actor who played the mayor, a black actor. I think his last name is Esposito.
Oh, Giancarlo.
Yeah,
from Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul.
I thought he was great. I really enjoyed him in the movie. I mean, everybody's performance in it was kind of over the top. Like, a lot of it was sort of overacted, but I kind of think that was part of the whole sort of Megalopolis world. Oh my God. Yeah, Shia LaBeouf. He was insane in this movie. Did you guys know he's in it too? Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. He cross-dresses
in it. His comeback movie.
Yeah. He dresses in ladies' clothes. He's like a very crazy character. And he was actually pretty good. I enjoyed him in it, even though.
Yeah. The things I know about this movie, and this is could be considered a spoiler alert, so fast forward if you want. We get Shia LaBeouf and drag, we get Dominatrix Aubrey Plaza, and we get an Adam Driver sex tape. Mm-hmm. Those are the three things I know about this movie.
Yes. All true.
Yeah.
Eli actually has a letterboxed list for each of those three categories as well. Adam Driver sex tape list. Is you directed all these. I'm going to make that joke every episode.
Shia LaBeouf in drag. We have Disturbia. We have
Eagle Eye.
Eagle Eye.
Holes.
The one he directed. I'm very excited to see this movie.
I forgot about Aubrey Plaza in it, but she stole the show. She was amazing. I walked out of the theater and I was like, she was incredible, and she was perfect for the part too. And it's fun to see her like expand her oeuvre and what she does, kind of. Like, she was phenomenal. Yeah.
Did you ever see Emily the Criminal?
Good movie.
Oh, I need to see it.
She's so good.
Yeah.
Good.
She's such a good actress.
Yeah.
I'm excited for her.
Yeah. And what is, like, an average day at Cannes, like, when you're reporting, what does it look like when you're there?
Great question. So usually I go to 2 or 3 screenings a day. So I'm up at like 7 to try and get to one of the early screenings. Get in the queue. You have to wait like 30 minutes, go in, take your seat. And then most of the screenings take place at the Palais, which is like this giant building with multiple screenings and terraces and balconies. And it's like very cool and labyrinthian. And so I watch the movie, then run to the press room, get my free coffee there, write my review, maybe go enjoy the view of the French Riviera on the balcony, and then go to another movie, write another review. And then in the evening, like, the parties are so much fun too. Like, every year the variety party is really cool. Ron Howard was there this year, which was very exciting. He was honored this year. And then it's a grind, but like exceptionally fun and glamorous. And, you know, it's like, oh, there's Cate Blanchett and there's Ron Howard. But the days are long, but really fun. And then you just kind of have to, like, it's also my friends there. We all talk about this. So it's like, it's so much go, go, go. And so fun that you often forget to eat, because it's like you're running to screenings and they don't really sell food at the Palais and stuff. So, but they have this free coffee bar. So everyone is just like amped on coffee. and then by the time it's evening and you're going to the parties and having cocktails, it's like, you've eaten nothing all day. You've drank 20 cups of coffee and now you're having champagne. And so it's just like, everyone's system is a little bit like crazy too. It's a lot of fun.
So you must have been in like social situations with celebrities or like, you know, certainly people whose films are there. What's your attitude towards interacting with them, engaging with them? Is there like an unspoken rule, like you nod and don't say anything? Do you make small talk? What do you do?
Usually I make small talk, chat with people. Yeah. And when I first started going to the festival, like I had no qualms about like going up to a celebrity and asking for a picture with them. Now that I'm like a little bit more seasoned, I'm like, I don't know if I would bug them. But for instance, one of my favorite con memories is when I saw Pam Anderson walking out of the Carlton, and I was like, oh my God, Pam. And I used to watch Baywatch all the time when I was a kid.
Yeah.
And so I ran up to her. I was like, Pam, I love you. Can I have a picture with you? And she was so nice and gracious and generous. So I took a picture with her. But like these days, to answer your question, Ethan, I'll like chat with people, and everyone like wants to talk about their thing, wants to talk about why they're there and their project. And as someone who's like kind of on the other side as a press, as observer, I'm just there to kind of soak it all up. So I'm happy to like hear what everyone's working on. And a lot of times when I'm talking to talent or filmmakers and they find out what I do, they'll be kind of more interested and kind of like, sure. I also have this app I just started. Oh, you know, that did happen this year. Really nice woman. But she was like, you know, I have this app I just started. I just wrote a book. I'd love to talk to you about it. So everyone is like kind of pushing something, but in a sweet way. It's like, it's just a bunch of film lovers all together and trying to like, you know, carve out their place in the artistic field.
Does their reaction change based on who you're writing for? If you're like, I write for Variety, are they like, I know that name.
Totally, totally. Sure. Yeah, it very much does. Yeah, yeah.
Before we get too far, what's the longest standing ovation you were a part of at Cannes this year?
Yes. So I'm going to tell you, it was the film that won the prize for Uncertain Regards. So there are multiple, you guys may know this already, there are multiple categories at Cannes. So there's In Competition, there's Uncertain Regard, there's Director's Fortnight, and Cannes Acid, which is like the kind of weirder arty films. Anyway, so there's a ton of prizes to be won. And the one that had the longest standing ovation that I was there for, it won the Uncertain Regard prize. And it was called L'Histoire de Soliman, The Story of Soliman. Was like an 11-minute standing ovation. All the actors had tears streaming down their faces. The producers, like everyone was just wildly clapping. And the one of the like very cool things about Cannes, for better or for worse, is how like vocal all the audiences are. And I do mean for worse. Like I was in a screening first year I was there, some Rob Pattinson movie that was like not that great in my opinion. And people were like booing and shouting. And this was during a premiere screening, like when the talent and everybody was there. It's just awkward. It's like, it's just the premiere of their movie. Maybe don't like yell out things. But on the flip side, people, when they love something, they're super vocal. And so, yeah, probably like an 11-minute standing ovation for The Story of Soliman. It's this film about a refugee from Guinea in Paris. He's a food delivery person, and it's a really, really great movie. And it all takes place over the course of like 48 hours, which I like. The pacing of the movie was really good. Yeah. But, and I heard that Substance, the Demi Moore movie, I think it got like a 13-minute standing ovation.
Yeah.
I wasn't at that screening, but I heard that was great. Yeah.
That's the one that Ethan and I have been talking a lot about, Substance.
Nice.
It got a lot of very I mean, we love horror, body horror movies, and it got so much positive. But yeah, that's why I didn't mention Caroline. She absolutely will never see this movie.
I love Demi Moore.
Question for you guys as horror fans. Like, I read in all the reviews of The Substance, you know, it says like body horror. What's the difference between a horror movie and body horror?
So We did a series of episodes on the history of horror, and we did it was Febu Scary, a month of horror movies.
Okay.
Come on. And we broke down horror as if it's the idea of spicy food, where yes, there is this big thing that we call spicy food that we call horror, but then you can break it down into different subgenres. You can break it down into psychological horror or monster horror or body horror or
Cronenberg is probably Cronenberg, the best yeah. known, like The Fly with Jeff Goldblum, and it's like the horror really occurs on one's body. If you speaking of SNL, like Sarah Sherman says that she does body horror comedy, so a lot of her like gross body stuff is sort of what she loves Cronenberg as an example.
Yeah, she's very much inspired by that type of thing, but uses it for humor. She even did that before SNL when she was Sarah Squirm. That was like her entire shtick. She's the best. We stan Sarah Squirm. Did that answer your question?
It did.
I don't know if it did.
Thank you.
Speaking of horror movies, real quick, In a Violent Nature comes out next week, and I mentioned it on this podcast, but I never actually talked about it. I saw it at the Milwaukee Film Festival. That is a very fascinating movie that's getting really good reviews.
Is that the following the serial killer one?
Yeah. It basically takes the idea of Brutal. Friday the 13th, like a slasher film, but it changes the perspective. So instead of following the victims, you're following the person killing. It's a cool movie in concept. I liked it a lot. The acting is not good. It's kind of like college student acting, if that makes sense. But there is one death scene that is one of the coolest gore effects I've seen on screen. So I do recommend seeing it. Caroline, not you. but it's cool that it takes a trope and flips it on its head. It's something that I like about current horror movies is that it understands the history of horror and tries to do something new. That's why I like Late Night with the Devil so much this year, for example. All right, Anne. 11 minute standing ovation. The movie ends.
Yes.
These are questions I actually wrote down, and it's all related to standing ovations because I'm obsessed with the idea that you haven't eaten all day. You've literally only drinking coffee.
Yes.
The movie ends. Everyone stands and starts clapping. I can do this for maybe 10 seconds. And then at a certain point, everyone's still clapping and you're looking around like, huh, everyone's still clapping. And then you have to keep going. At what point does your body go, this fucking sucks. I don't want to clap anymore. Everybody stop. Horizon wasn't a good movie. Why are we doing this for 8 minutes? Holy shit. I don't care if this guy's crying. I'm done. I'm done clapping.
I think everybody just gets an adrenaline rush from it, especially if you love the movie and everyone's really into it. And like they happen at these premiere screenings. So it's like all the talent is there and to see them get so excited. And there's also like for a standing ovation that is that long, there's like a rhythm and a dynamism to it. So it's not just like static clapping, clapping, clapping. You know, it's like people and then it's like, wah! And like, so it kind of, it's just cool. It changes. It's not just like the same for 10 minutes. And then like the festival director will also come down and like raise the hand in the air of the actors, or like the camera will be there and they'll do different photos. But yeah, everyone just gets super into it and you kind of forget that your hands feel like they're going to fall off.
Yeah, I honestly wonder if it's European. Like, because I saw August Osage County and Czech when I was studying in Europe, and I remember they went through the curtain call 6 times, and people were just on their feet applauding. And I wonder if it's just a European thing that, like, in response to all art forms.
Yeah, could very well be. Yeah, that's interesting.
For the record, I would stand for 11 minutes to clap for Margot Martindale any day.
I have a question about standing ovations. Well, it's more a question for the group. Do you know the movie that has gotten the longest standing ovation at Cannes in history?
Can I ask a follow-up? One question.
Yeah.
Was it in the last 2 years?
No.
I have no idea. But I'm going to guess the length of the standing ovation.
And length.
I'm going to guess, my immediate thought is 18 minutes.
No.
How many minutes?
Longer or shorter?
I'm going to guess 35 minutes.
Price is Right rules, Anne is correct. Eli busted.
Okay.
It is 22. Oh, sorry.
Oh, just because I have a...
gave it away.
I have a movie guess. Is it Tree of Life?
It's not Tree of Life.
Okay,
Ethan.
Yeah.
When you say longest standing ovation, is this the audience standing or just you? Because if it's just you, it's K-Pax.
Listen, it's a beautiful film with Jeff Bridges and Kevin Spacey eating a banana peel. It's the audience. It is not an English film. It is in Spanish.
¿Y tu mama también?
That's what I was going to guess, too.
No. But not the same director, but you're in a category of director that are all
Roma?
Sort of... No.
Was it Roma?
Not that director.
Oh, I got it. Okay. Pan's Labyrinth?
Correct.
Oh.
22 minutes.
Wow.
In second place, Fahrenheit 9/11, 20 minutes. In third place, Mud, the McConaughey movie, 18 minutes. The Paperboy, 15 minutes.
Oh, The Paperboy rules. Caroline, have you seen The Paperboy?
No, but I'm excited for their reunion on Netflix.
Oh, that's right. Zac Efron and
Nicole Kidman. Yeah.
And in fifth place is Elvis. Were you at the Elvis con screening?
I was not at the premiere of it, but I was at the con where it played. Yeah, that was last year.
Cool.
And I remember people being very excited about it.
I want to go through a list of movies that I've been tracking, and I want to know if you've seen them or not, and if you have anything you're able to say about them.
Okay.
Lightning round. Obviously, the big one I want to see is Anora. It won the Palme d'Or. It's Sean Baker, who's one of my favorite directors. The first American to win the Palme d'Or since Tree of Life. Did you see Anora?
I did not see Anora, but everyone who I spoke to, they were like, it's going to win the Palme d'Or. It's like there was just a buzz about it in the same way that
Even online.
Yeah.
Even online from a distance, people were like, it's over.
Yeah. I'm really intrigued by it. I've got to see it. It's the same thing that happened with Parasite. It's like even before Parasite swept the awards, there's always like one film that they're like, that everyone's talking about that they're saying, oh, you got to see this. This is going to win the Palme. But yeah. I'm intrigued by it. I heard it was great.
I am intrigued because we talk about the Oscars. One mission that the three of us have is we're trying to see every single Best Picture winner.
Nice.
Ever? From beginning to end. Yeah.
Wow. How many movies is that?
It's like 90. No, it should be 96.
96?
Yeah, because we're 4 years away from the 100th Oscars.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay.
And obviously, Khan... for the last, I don't know, was it like 12 years or something like that? At least one Best Picture nominee came from Cannes. I'm guessing it's going to be Anora. There was one other movie that got a lot of buzz right away for the Palme d'Or, which was Emilia Perez. Did you see that?
I did not get to see Emilia Perez, but similarly, there was a ton of buzz around it. And anytime you ask someone, oh, what did you think? Or what was it like? Everyone I spoke to about it, they're like, it's about a lot of things, but everyone had like the most positive experience of it and said it was like very fun and original. And yeah, there was some moment on the red carpet too that I feel like, or no, that's a separate thing. But yeah, big cast, super exciting red carpet moment.
Now, did you get into a fight with that security guard?
I did, Cobb? Yeah.
You sort of fought them? Yeah, they were
the
rushing you too much?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Did you see Kinds of Kindness?
I did. I really liked it. I think it plays well for con audiences and like cinephiles like yourselves, but I don't know how it will translate really to the general viewing public because it's pretty out there. It's a really, it's an interesting format. It's like a triptych, you know, it's three different stories with the actors like rotating the characters that they're playing, but I liked it. It was like, the casting was great. It was very original. And Emma Stone was awesome, per usual.
Did you like Poor Things?
I did like Poor Things, yeah. Yeah. I mean, there were some parts of it that... Overall, I liked it, yeah.
Okay. Caroline agrees with you. Will... our guy, Jesse Plemons, get an Oscar nomination? I know he won the award at Cannes.
Good question. I would guess he's probably going to be nominated. I don't know about...
That'll make me so happy.
Yeah.
I hope he gets the nomination. I will say I saw Sing Sing at the Chicago Critics Award, and there's a couple people there I would nominate for Best Supporting as well. But I just want Jesse Plemons to get that nomination. I love him so much. Will Emma Stone get another Oscar?
Maybe. Who knows?
Can you imagine?
Yeah, that would be pretty wild.
Crazy.
I feel like we turn against her at some point if she keeps winning.
Do you mean Emily Stone? Did you hear about that?
She wants to be called Emily now.
Yeah.
Is that real?
Because it's her real name, but she chose Emma for like staff-related reasons. Yeah.
That is...
All right, so we have Emily Stone and Annie Hathaway.
Yeah.
Oh, is that... Yeah, I forgot about that.
Yeah.
That's what I learned last
week. That's very Vanderpump Rules of her to go by Emma and then now Emily.
I'm Raquel now.
Lord.
And it was funny for the press junket for Kinds of Kindness. All these like French reporters and photographers and stuff were yelling, Emily, Emily, like when she was walking by. And cute.
I love that.
That's respectful.
That's sweet.
Yeah.
That is cute.
Yeah.
Did you see The Apprentice?
No, I heard it was like creepy and chilling and a little bit depressing. That's another one that also didn't get, as far as I know, has not gotten picked up for distribution yet. And there was some, like they were waiting to see kind of how American audiences at Cannes responded to it, or just audiences in general.
And what movies did you see? What movies did you like?
Okay,
are there any movies you didn't like?
There's a new version of The Count of Monte Cristo.
Ooh.
And I actually loved it. It's French language. It's a French production and everything. And, you know, there's been a zillion iterations of that story over the years on film. There's one with Gerard Depardieu. But, yeah, it was just really good and fun. It was over 3 hours long, and it was another 8:30 a.m. screening. So when I saw the runtime, I was like, and it was on one of the last days of the festival. I was like, am I going to make it through this thing? Like, I had my doubts, but I was pleasantly surprised by how it, like, very much captivated. And also, like, with those period pieces, period films, it's like, oh, I don't know. Am I going to, like, is this really going to hold my attention? But it did. It was great. Well-paced, good acting, really fun. Like I said, I loved the story of Suleiman. That was another good one. There was a film, honestly, some of them just like blend together a little bit. If it's not like a super out there megalopolis, like they all just sort of blend. But there was an African film that I really liked that was kind of like quieter. I have a friend, my friend who works at Universal and goes to Cannes too. Anytime the movie was kind of slow or a little bit boring, he would describe it as patient, and so that became our go-to word when a movie was a bit slow. So the African film, I'll look up the name and send it to you guys afterwards, but it was very good, but it was also patient. It was slow moving.
Patient is such a nice way. I call them film festival movies. Like what is it, Good One? I saw Good One earlier this year. I know that played Cannes this year. It's a patient movie.
And I was just thinking about, since you said you mostly see a lot of the French movies, I have like, loved Anatomy of a Fall on this podcast. So I have two important questions for you. One, did you see Messi last year?
The dog.
Oh, no, I didn't. No.
Because I know he won Best Dog at the con last year.
In our hearts.
And what were your thoughts, like on Anatomy of a Fall, and I guess like especially since you do a lot of reporting on the French films, France chose to not submit it to the Oscars for Best International Feature because of her speech about Macron and the politics within that. So I think like, what was the general feeling with that?
That's a good question. I didn't follow that story too closely about that. What's that actress's name? Sandra
Hüller.
Cooler.
Yeah.
But it makes sense why France did that, because I feel like, similar to in the U.S., politics are very hot right now in France. Mm-hmm.
And thank you so much.
And where do they find you? Where does everyone find you if they want to read you, listen,
etc.? Yeah, you can go to annemccarthy.me, my website, and I have a newsletter, weekly Friday newsletter you can subscribe to and see my recent reporting and updates on my novel. I have a book that's going to be coming out later. So yeah, follow me on annemccarthy.me, and it has all my social media and newsletter stuff on there.
Amazing.
Yeah.
And thank you so much for your time. Thank you for talking to us about God.
Thank you, guys.
I have 1,000 follow-up questions, but they're all related to Standing Ovation. So we'll have you back after you see Fury Road.
I would love that.
Thank you for listening. Please remember to rate, review. I don't like doing this part. Caroline, you do it.
Sure. If you're enjoying the podcast, please.
Do it in French.
Do it in French.
Not right
do
now.
It in French.
It's 10 a.m. I'm not speaking in French.
Sing it.
Ugh, je ne parle pas le français maintenant. Okay, so you can rate and review us on the wherever you listen to us, and we hope that you go see movies in theaters.
Yay! Thank you for listening, and as always,
Ethan wants to go to Cannes.
Come with me.
And let him buy Megalopolis.
Send me to Cannes for Horizon Part 4.
There's going to be a fourth?
Yes, he's making four of them.
Four.
Oh, no. What?
Who asked? Self-financed?
Ethan asked.
I did.
Yes.